We are arriving. After having pressed charges against ourselves in Kristiansand for having committed structural violence against two poor Brazilians, after opening a criminal complaints office at the harbor, after leaving the country in our investigation vehicle, after finding proofs against ourselves in Rio de Janeiro, we are now back, arriving in the same investigation vehicle.
This is the personal encounter with world politics. Here is the accused and investigator Blaue Poppy, and inside this wet suitcase we have our findings, very hot proofs against ourselves. I am the accused and investigator Julian Blaue, and this is the law against structural violence that we founded here in Kristiansand some month ago. We will now demonstrate in which ways we have broken our own law, revealing our findings. Please follow us on the highway of art towards a new legal order. This is the interim report performance presented at the prestigious University of Agder. A fact that probably will give us Blaue and Poppy cultural capital. I mean, there are real professors here in the audience. Oh yeah. And this cultural capital, we estimate, is equivalent to 1,250 happiness points. Our happiness points, we discussed that among others with you. I mean, how do we count them? We have a scale. And it is from 0 to 50,000 happiness points. And it's, yeah, the life quality of one incident we measure here. And no life quality is zero. A lot of life quality is 50,000. But what does a lot of mean? It means that we are referring to one incident as it actually is compared to how it could be at its
very best. So this performance here could, for instance, also be shown at MoMA in New York City to amazing reviews worldwide. Maybe in the audience we could have the performance curator of Tate Modern inviting us immediately to have a retrospective of all our performances. Plus, maybe Slavo Žižek would be in the audience and develop a new philosophy inspired by us. Then we would gain 50,000 happiness points. Okay.
Zero.
Yes. If the performance would not happen at all, would be zero happiness points. So you're getting a little bit the picture here of the scale. Okay, so let's get out of the formalities for a little bit and into the core of the interim report. So, Christmas Eve 2015, Julian, our little son, you see his legs there, and we were celebrating it in Rio de Janeiro. And then we got assaulted by two poor young men from a favela. They pulled out a big knife and shouted, "Give us everything you have." Scared to death, literally, we did as they asked. Nevertheless, these pictures that you just saw are all from that evening. And the reason is that we got our camera back with blood on it, because the police caught one of the assaulters in a street fight. So here you can see Julian and our son Bela just after the street fight at the police the tourist police office here. Luckily for us, our six-month-old son, he slept through everything. He slept through the assault, he slept through the street fight, and through the interrogations afterwards. He just slept and slept. But for Julian and me, the evening was very traumatic. And I can feel like my voice is getting emotional. And at this point here, I'm feeling very much like a victim. And I think when I look at the picture, I feel also that I look a bit like a ghost. Something in me has gone, but something else has not come into me yet. And it means that it's going to take some while for me to change that view of me and Julian and our little family as victims. So at this point, we want to try to express as well these feelings in numbers. So Blaue and Poppy, how can we express this moment in our life in numbers? So what is happening to us? Okay, we're having the fear of losing our lives. It was a big knife. I've never been so scared in my whole life. We also had the fear of losing the loved other. We were kind of in a honeymoon. Other. Plus the loved child. On top of that, we had this vision. It was our first kind of Christmas together to have it in Rio de Janeiro next to Cristo de Redentor, who is in this Lagoa lake that we just showed you, blessing us. So I will give us a little bit also for destroyed Christmas. So that's not so much, but still, it was a disappointment. So I will say 7,000 unhappiness points for this. Okay, but what about the guys who assaulted us? They are named Gomez and Santos. We know it because Gomez got caught by the police, and therefore they also got the name of Santos, who was underaged. And okay, so what did their evening look like? We know that Gomez got a little bit injured in the street fight with the police. So he's gonna get a little bit for injury. Okay, and we suppose that they also had the fear of losing their lives, because the police in Rio is quite notorious for killing people from the favela. So here I would say it's equal to us. They probably also had the fear of losing the other. I'm not sure if it was the loved one, but they were definitely operating as a team. So maybe they were friends. So we give that also the same. I think that they also had a destroyed Christmas. I don't think they had the same vision as us maybe, but they definitely had the idea of getting back with some money, which they didn't. So it was a disappointment, I'm pretty sure. So here it's also equal to us. So the only thing, well, they have the injury, but we have something that I think is bigger than the injury, because the injury was not very bad. It's the loved child. And again, it's so, the trauma is in the body, because, you know, we were, Bela was in his pram, and the pram was rolling away. We were in the corner, and I thought, they're going to either kidnap him or kill him. And at that point, I thought, I might as well die, or it's worse to live than him being dead. So I think that here, they don't get anything, which is going to make our unhappiness in this moment bigger than theirs. We're going to give them 6,000 unhappiness points for this. So in our scale here, we also have a scale for unhappiness points. So we think like the maximum of life disaster, we would also express between 0, the minimum of life disaster, kind of no life disaster, and the maximum by 50,000. And so here we are referring to one terrible incident, how it actually is compared to how it could be
at its worst. And our assaulters would then, for instance, have cut our throats, and they would themselves, as Edie also told, have been killed by the brutal military police in Rio. It's nevertheless a quite realistic scenario in the violent jungle
of globalized capitalism. And that would then, again, to explain the scale, be 50,000 unhappiness points, no assault, zero unhappiness points. Okay, but how did the story continue? In February 2016, we were back in Norway, and then we changed this view. We started to change this view that Edie talked about and understood our two assaulters, Gomez and Santos, are probably on the bottom of a global economic hierarchy, whereas we are in the middle. The assault on us is also an attack on that hierarchy. We concluded that we, like most of the global middle and upper classes, like I guess all of you, are involved in structural violence against the underclasses. And I wrote about this for the Norwegian paper Nyetid. You see here, Overfallet war in Undervisningstime i global Utviklingspolitik. And I earned 5,000 Norwegian kroner and cultural capital equivalent to 300 happiness points. We are also open for you suggesting another number. It's about finding the truth. In September, some of you will recognize yourself. In September 2017, I started a, I think, well-paid PhD project here at UJA, the Personal Encounter with World Politics, where I and we, with artistic means, try to criticize the production of poverty in globalized capitalism through our experience with the assault in Rio de Janeiro. Thus, the crime against me and my family has indirectly made me earn 476,000 Norwegian kroner so far for a project about poverty. I'd say that's equivalent to 20,000 happiness points. I mean, it means we can work artistically. It's really great, thanks to the assault. 20,000 happiness points. How did the story continue? Okay, now let's talk a little bit more about the scale. Because it's kind of an error to say it's just the incident at its best and at its worst. When you look at the last two numbers, you see all this talk about formalities. It fits really good to the university, no? We talk always about formalities in the university. When you look at the last two numbers, you see the scale doesn't only compare incidents with the same incident at their best or worst. A PhD at University of Agder is not only compared with a PhD at the world's leading university. The incidents are also compared with each other. A PhD gives me more happiness points than a published article, for instance. Okay, but now, really, let's quit the formalities and talk about what happened then. In April 2018, I had the opportunity to publish another essay about the assault in the art magazine EE. And here I express, inspired by Sartre and Fanon, my feeling of shame confronted with the fact of being co-responsible for the situation of the underprivileged. And I'm inspired by Fanon, who says even that shame is a revolutionary sentiment. If the people who are in power would feel more shame, they would probably change something. So I express this feeling of shame for being co-responsible for the fate of the underprivileged. Nevertheless, I'm the proud cover boy of the magazine. The assaulters have indirectly helped our project getting the aura of hot, dangerous art. In all, we got 724 likes for this, cultural capital worth, I would say, happiness points.
1,200.
1,200. So, but this story is not over yet. The success story from based on the assault on us. In May 2018, we had a criminal complaint performance here at Sørlandets Art Museum. We founded a law against structural violence and ended up pressing charges against ourselves for having benefited from committing this crime against the underclasses, represented by the two assaulters from the favela. And here you see the criminal complaint office. You saw it also outside. The performance gave us cultural capital, 15,000 Norwegian kroner, 500 likes on Facebook, and several good reviews. All this is equivalent to 2,000 happiness points. Okay, but now let's switch focus from our success to their fate. In August 2018, just some weeks ago, we went back to the crime scenes in Rio.
Yeah, so this is the Lagoa Lake where it happened, and now it's in daylight 2.5 years later.
You saw it in the beginning, in the evening. We are now back on our investigation journey after a criminal complaint. You have to investigate what you are accused for. So since we accuse ourselves, we have also to do the investigation ourselves. We want to find out more about our assaulter's situation. We want to meet them, looking for proofs to build a strong case against ourselves. And let's find out if we met them, and if yes, how that ended.
Or how it began. So here we are at the Rio's tourist police office.
You probably recognize it from the beginning. There it was blue, but it's the same office.
Yeah, it's where we saw the pictures of Julian and our little son, and later also me. And I think if you have a little look at the sign here, in retrospect, the hat that Julian has, the Panama hat, is fitting quite well to the tourist police office idea of what someone who gets assaulted or robbed would look like. So maybe not so strange then that we got robbed and assaulted. Anyway, so this is, we are here at the tourist police office, and we are lucky because the same police officer who interrogated us in 2015, he is at work. And he remembers us being some of many victims that Christmas, actually many more than previous Christmases. Because in 2015, criminality increased in Brazil as a result of the World Cup and the Olympics. And the reason was that a lot of the money that was for social programs, they went instead to build stadiums. And in order to build up the infrastructure for the mega events, some of the favela houses had to be removed.
We link the police officer's observation of increased criminality, we've been there many hours, now it's already dark, to our involvement in violent structures against the underclasses, as we already did when we pressed charges against ourselves here at Sørlandets Art Museum. But now it is really confirmed, the connection between assault and the sports events. And also we, Blaue and Poppy, supported from that mega events, OL and World Cup. How? We are not sport enthusiasts, but nevertheless, we watched OL and World Cup where Germany won. I'm German. we watched it at TV, so we enjoyed that a little bit at least, and gained some happiness points, 10, I would say. But how is it with Gomez and Santos? Yeah, it's very likely that the two men decided to rob us because they had suffered from this increased poverty from the effect of the mega events. And we would, yeah, we. I think it's right to give them maybe 20,000 unhappiness points for the poverty, which can mean all that, what Edi mentioned, houses were removed in the favelas, social programs didn't exist anymore. So Gomez and Santos, 20,000 unhappiness points for this poverty linked to OL and the World Cup. Yeah, I think we can call it VC. Okay, but we're still here at the police office talking to the officer, and he says to find out more about our assaulters, he can't help us. We have to go to U Palacio da Justiça, the Palace of Justice.
And here they tell us that the oldest of the two assaulter, he was in prison until September 2017 and is now released on parole. So once a month he has to come to a prison office to sign in proving that he isn't a fugitive. The youngest assaulter was never imprisoned. Their contact information cannot be handed out. Of course, having been in prison and having to sign in is already a painful effect of our structural violence and evidence against us. So we estimate that the jailed of the two assaulters, Gomez and Santos, well, that he maybe lost some, let's say, 30,000 reais for not being able to work, that means maybe robbing tourists, during his stay in prison. Also, we think that the story of having been caught was not a heroic one, and they might have gotten many dislikes in the favela. All this, plus the suffering from the imprisonment, we think it could be equivalent to 25,000 unhappiness points for them for imprisonment. Plus, plus, plus.
Okay, still at the Palacio da Justiça, just another angle, with the police, the UPP police, which is famous for entering the favela in the background. Still here, we have to say that we're also interpreting the news Edi just talked about positively as a proof of minimal civil rights for the very poor. The teenager, Santos, was never jailed. That's pretty good, I think. The sentenced man is released from prison on parole. The assaulter's juridical privacy is respected. But can we respect it? Meeting at least one of them is a main goal for our investigation journey. So we are relatively lucky again. The employees are allowed to give us the address of the prison. Maybe we can find out when the oldest assaulter is due to sign in next time and meet him then. We go to this shabby prison office situated in the poor northern part of Rio de Janeiro.
So here we are unlucky. The employees tell us that the oldest assaulter only showed up to sign in once and never again, which means that he's on the run now. So we're asking ourselves, how can we find him if even the police can't? And that makes us get discouraged. Nevertheless, we are as close to him as ever before because we've just been inside the same prison office where he once was, and we've had the chance to see what he was forced to see. In other words, what we saw could be a significant evidence in the trial against ourselves.
Yeah, so we're finding out what did he have to see in that prison office where we are right now and where he was. In the prison office waiting room there are tons of proverbs on the wall. From the Bible, Buddha, African tribes. Our assaulter must have read them. For instance, kindness creates kindness, or your ideas should be high, but your voice low. Can these proverbs really help poor criminals in the age of hardcore Darwinist neoliberalism, where aggression creates aggression? And I think there are also tons of proverbs in Norwegian prisons, so we can't say it's only over there. How should the ideas of the poor ever change their situation if they wouldn't shout them out loudly? Among the proverb by religious leading lights, we also found this one by, you wouldn't guess it, by Steve Jobs. Each dream you leave behind is a part of your future that will no longer exist. Does Steve Jobs say to the prisoners? One of the first things I got when I started my PhD here at UJA was a MacBook Pro. I was very grateful. I could now type emoticons directly on the keyboard, an advantage compared to my old MacBook Air. Once more, I had the opportunity to support Steve Jobs, the spiritual leader of digitalized capitalism. The assault was, as you know, central in my PhD, so it isn't absurd to say our assaulter gave me a new MacBook Pro. I gave him a proverb from Steve Jobs. Let me explain. Let's again look at this proverb. Each dream, in Portuguese, of course, in Portuguese, cada sonho que você deixa para trás é pedaço do seu futuro que deixa de existir. Sounds even more pathetic in Portuguese. Each dream you leave behind is a part of your future that will no longer exist. In the prison office waiting room, I came to think on another proverb I'd like to see on the wall. Capitalism is distributing its dreams very equally, but not the means to make them real.
A proverb by the spiritual leader Julian Blaue, who's getting very good at how to get richer by exploring the poor, or something like that.
Yeah, okay, I have to confess, it's maybe not a proverb I have even remembered it or invented it. I don't know.
Somehow, so it's gone through your system.
Capitalism is distributing its dreams very equally, but not the means to make them real. Let me explain again. Big companies offer their dream to the poor through commercials on TV, enormous posters decorating the city, etc., everybody knows. Even if the poor have no chance of ever buying their products. That's one of the reasons why criminals from the favelas and other places, why poor criminals don't only steal food, but also, for instance, items from Apple. Look here, with his stoic career gaze, Jobs produced a dream in our assaulter, waiting in the prison office without telling him how to afford it. What else than the dream of eternal access to Apple products can Steve Jobs stand for in the eyes of a penniless criminal? I imagine that if this criminal looks at Steve Jobs, this dream he talks about is of course getting this one. But how to afford it? Jobs doesn't tell him. By being part of Steve Jobs' customer gang, we supported his attempt to give this poor criminal a dream, but not the means to fulfill it. And just a thought experiment. The assaulter seems to have understood the difference between dream and reality, and he solved the societal problem that showed up in the gap. In which ways? Yeah, I think, as Eddie told us, he never came back. By never coming back for signing in, by being on the run, by assaulting new middle and upper class people that would support the production of new dreams without providing the means to fulfill them. by demanding the fulfillment on his own? Okay, that's just an experiment, but might be. We give ourselves 200 happiness points for the MacBook Pro. And our sorters, we give, what did we say, 20,000?
Yeah. No, 2,000. Yeah. Come on. Okay.
2,000 for hopeless dreams produced by this guy. And then by this guy and by this girl.
And by maybe some of you in the audience here also.
Okay, we don't have to offend anybody.
What do they say? You know who you are.
Okay, yeah.
So, we have now presented some evidences for and against our case. There are no law institutions where we can hand in our proofs because there is no governmental law against structural violence. The only law that exists in the world that we know about is our own, founded in an artistic context. So the only institutions that have been so far open to our findings are art institutions and universities. So we take it as a first step in changing the governmental law. Therefore, the first place we took it to the proofs we found in Rio was to the very prestigious Museo de Arte de Rio, the Rio Art Museum. And here in the end of August, we managed with very simple means, as you can see here and as you can see here, just some paper and a pen, to make a controversial debate. So during the festival Trans Incorporados...
This whole performance is one big commercial, you see. I mean, we're really good artists. What do you want to tell? Okay.
Well, anyway, I want to say that people were either very disgusted or euphoric about our findings. And it was very special to present it in the city of the assault. It gave an extra dimension maybe, or people were feeling even more attacked or co-guilty, I'm not sure. But anyway, something happened and we were quite happy to manage to make an impact in the city of the assault. So I'm gonna give us 4,000 happiness points for this performance in Rio. So, a lot of happiness from unhappiness here. Anyways, now we are here at the University of Agder and we are presenting our findings to you. So, we will now sum up the three battle strikes. Come here, baby. So, we acted out structural violence against our assaulters by watching the Olympics and the World Cup in Brazil. We struck them, so to say. So, we're gonna find out how this calculation, what it's leading to, who are the losers and who are the winners. So we're gonna do step by step. This is the first battle strike, and it's kind of pre-assault. How did we build up to the assault? So, I guess, without being a mathematical genius, it's very easy here. I think I will manage to copy this. 10 happiness points for Blaue and Poppy for this medium pleasure of watching sports events on TV, compared to 20,000 unhappiness points for Santos and Gomez for increased poverty. So I think it's pretty clear it's about getting the most happiness, even if ours is not so much to right home about, it's still a lot compared to their 20,000 unhappiness points. So I guess, darling, the first battle strike is for us. And I think we can go a little...
But then, as you have heard, After that, they assaulted us Christmas Eve 2015. They struck back. And also that we have to illustrate. So we are here now on the second battle strike, as I would call it in the liberal world, where happiness is winning. How is it here? Do I have to be a mathematical genius? No. 6,000 unhappiness points for Gomez and Santos because they feared a lot, but not losing their child. We feared a lot losing a child, losing the other one, losing our own life, destroyed Christmas. They had it also. But they had less. We had 7,000, suffered most, and lost.
Right, so the second battle strike goes for them. So now it's very exciting. It's 1-2-1 here. So the final battle strike, come here so we can find out, is going to be the decisive one. So we made one of them go to prison and co-produced a dream in him without giving him the means to fulfill it. On top of that, we transformed their strike into artistic capital. So we struck back again. So let's have a look at this then. And here, it would actually be good to have some help from the audience. Does anybody have, for instance, an iPhone or something and can get this number in here? Can I get some help? The gentleman on the first row here, would you please help me? So then we have 1,250 happiness points for cultural capital for Uya. And then we have...
That's this performance.
There's so much happiness that I'm even forgetting what it's all about. So thank you so much, Julian, for reminding me why I should be happy. And then it's 300, and that's for an article, I think, Nitit. Then 20,000, that's for the PhD, and the whole family is so, so happy about that. Then, well, we were a little bit unhappy in the beginning because we had to come to Kristiansand, and that would give us a little bit of unhappiness points in the beginning. But then Kristiansand revealed itself to be quite okay, so we're back to happiness points. But in the beginning, I was not so happy about that, I have to admit. Anyways, now we are here, and then it's 1,200. What is that for again?
I think that was EE.
Yes, for the cover boy. How could we forget? And then it's 2,000 for...
Good question.
Does anybody remember? I think we have written it here. Should we believe in the numbers?
No, that was the performance at Sørlands Art Museum.
Okay, yeah. Another performance, and then the MacBook Pro, and then 4,000 for the performance in Rio. How much does that make? 28,950 happiness points. 28,950 happiness points. That's a lot of happiness, I would say. All right. Oh, and here it's third battle strike. Oh, and I even forgot to change the image.
Yeah,
oh my
we
god.
The third battle strike.
Yes. Whew. Anyway, so this looks more right. Anyway, so then they have 25,000 for imprisonment, etc., plus 2,000 for hopeless dreams. That makes 27,000 unhappiness points, which means that we won. And I think we should celebrate. I'm so fucking tired of always being ashamed.
Let's open a bottle of champagne
and celebrate with you guys.
Let's forget about suffering just for a moment.
Let's celebrate. We also need to celebrate sometimes. In the rain, it's been raining so much in Kristiansand.
Let's forget about suffering, just for a moment at least.
So?
Let's forget about our law against structural violence.
Can I share with you? Does anybody want? It's very good. It's actually instead, real champagne.
We want to celebrate we now perceive as our victory.
Yes.
That's a very
Who
big point.
Ask?
We couldn't have done that
no here?
Without
anybody
you.
Here?
Our victory is
you
your victory.
Yes.
Let's
we couldn't have
drink
done it
champagne.
Without you.
And let's listen to Elvis Presley. Elvis Presley.
More. Anybody can get.
He is the king of rock and roll, wealth and decadence. Let's listen to his famous hit, In the Ghetto. A hit that has made people shed tears all over the world.
With more champagne.
Honoring the two men from the favela.
Spread the champagne.
We show it with Brazilian subtitles.
There is for everybody. We have four bottles.
There's a snowfly on a golden gray Chicago morning. I want to be the child that's born in the ghetto. And his mama cried.
Can you help me distribute champagne, darling? Can you help me distribute the champagne?
The only thing she don't need is another hungry mouth to feed in the ghetto.
Let's forget about Shanky Robin.
Actually, Elvis happened to be maybe not so right. Let's remember everything again. Let's not
just
forget.
For a moment.
And what happened here? We got so excited that the image disappeared. Right.
Say hello to the kindergarten. Summa summarum. They stroke once, we stroke twice.
So the party is over. Our next performance will be our trial against ourselves. We are convinced of our guilt. Are you? We think that our guilt is your guilt or our victory is your victory.
Let the judge decide.